Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala asyrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillah, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this blessed day, Sunny of Sha'ban. And we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with goodness in dunya and goodness in akhirah, and open for us the doors of understanding and the doors of guidance, that we are able to obey Him in His commandments and refrain from His prohibitions. So inshallah we will enter into our session Q&A. We have a few questions today. The first question is asking, Assalamualaikum Ustaz. Waalaikumsalam. Is it permissible or encouraged to do sujood after victory in sports, like those we see in soccer matches? So this is the first question, where the questioner is asking, is it permissible to do sujood in sports? What is meant by this sujood is sujood shukr. There is something that is called sujood ashukr. We have sujood shukr and sujood tilawah. When it comes to sujood tilawah, it is the sujood that we perform when we recite any of the 14 verses in the Quran, which is a sunnah for us to do sujood after the recitation. This sujood then is called sujood tilawah. There is another type of sujood that is known as sujood shukr. So we have to understand what is the meaning of sujood shukr, and what are the situations that it is a sunnah for us to do sujood shukr. When it comes to sujood shukr, our ulama and the fuqaha, they mention that when a person is blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a great blessing, when a person is blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a great blessing, it is a sunnah for him to do sujood shukr. Or if he is saved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from a big calamity, it is a sunnah for him to do sujood shukr. So the definition of sujood shukr is a sujood that is performed after a person receive immense blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or a person is protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from great calamities, then only we say it is a sunnah to do sujood shukr. So to make this easier for us to understand, I will give an example. For example, there are people who doesn't have a child for many years. A couple and got married for 20 years, no child. And suddenly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with a child. So we say this is a great blessing, and this is something that does not come by often. So we tell this couple sunnah to do sujood shukr, because this is in a form of a great blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with. And likewise, if a person was saved by Allah from a big calamity, recently the earthquake in Turkey and Syria, I was informed by a friend who is living in Turkey. He said there is a child who stayed in the rubble for 3 weeks and survived. So people were amazed, how can a child survive in 3 weeks, no food, no water? This child is literally under the rubble, under the rubble. Normal any human beings, we say maybe 3 days, 4 days, 5 days. Normal human being cannot any survive without food and water, let's say for 5 days or 6 days. But this child didn't survive any for 3 weeks. So when they remove any the child, they ask the child, how come, what happened to you? How come any you manage any to survive? So he said that every day there is someone who is dressed any in white came to me and give me food and water. This is a miracle. And this is not one case, many cases. This is what happened any in Turkey recently. So in this any situation, we say that it is a sunnah to make sujood al-shukr because this is a miracle. There is also any a person who survived a plane crash. The whole passengers died except any for one person. Survive. Subhanallah. Every passenger any in the plane crash and he died, he survived. This situation any we say sunnah for him to do sujood al-shukr. So this is the meaning of sujood al-shukr. So point number one, and is either a person receive a lot of blessings any from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and number two, a person who is safe any from calamities. So we say sunnah for him to do sujood al-shukr. But if a person say, I want to do sujood al-shukr every day sujood al-shukr. There are some people, for example, they say every day sujood al-shukr. We ask them the question, why are you doing sujood al-shukr? He said, I am making shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the ni'mah that Allah has blessed me with. So we say this kind of sujood is not any within the ruling of sujood al-shukr. Sujood al-shukr is not any meant any for general blessings. But it is meant any for specific any blessing. And a blessing any that comes out of the ordinary. This is sujood al-shukr. So it is not a sunnah for a person to do sujood al-shukr every day. Like after every prayer, sujood al-shukr. Not a sunnah to do that. So going back to the question, is it permissible to do sujood al-shukr after victory any in sports? Now when we ask any the question, is victory any in sport something that is considered to be a big any blessing any from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is ordinary, extraordinary? The answer any is, it is not. Any victory any in sports is a victory, a sign any of achievement, any a person manage any to win any certain things. So this is not any within any sujood al-shukr. But if a person any does any sujood al-shukr, the second thing any is that he has any to observe the conditions of the validity of sujood al-shukr. Nowadays, you see, for example, football players, after they score a goal, they do sujood al-shukr. So number one, and we have to understand, sujood al-shukr is like prayers. You need to have wudu. You have to face any the qibla. You have to do the takbir. And you have to cover the aura. So sometimes, we see people doing sujood al-shukr, they just go down and they do any sujood. Sometimes, they do not know anywhere is the qibla, and sometimes when they do sujood al-shukr, they wear shorts. Now it is not valid. Even if you were to say that it is a sunnah to do sujood al-shukr and you have the victory in sports, there must be this any conditions. So I hope this is sufficient for us to understand the basis of sujood al-shukr. Jadi soalan ni jemaah dirahmati Allah menanyakan tentang sujood al-shukr. Sujud syukur maksudnya apabila kita diberikan nikmat yang besar daripada Allah ataupun kita diselamatkan daripada musibah yang besar, disunatkan kita melakukan sujud syukur. Maka sujud syukur tidak disunatkan kita melakukan tiap-tiap hari tanpa sebab. Walaupun satu orang mengatakan saya bersyukur kepada Allah, bersyukur kepada Allah dengan cara yang lain, tapi sujud syukur dia khusus bagi nikmat yang besar ataupun selamat daripada musibah. The next question is asking, Assalamualaikum waalaikumsalam. I would like to ask, if given a situation where the husband is not doing well financially and wife voluntarily offered him funds from her savings to help him to support himself as well as to pay off debts, as wife wishes for debt-free family, is it required of the husband to pay the money back to his wife even though she offered it voluntarily? What are the rights in this situation? Jazakallah khair. And his second question, and he is asking, if wife voluntarily gives money to the husband, Can a wife any give money to the husband? If a wife any voluntarily give money to the husband, this is considered as, in Islam, many we call it any hibah. And it is like a gift. Somebody give us any some money. Is it compulsory upon the wife any to give money to the husband? No. But it is compulsory upon the husband to provide for the wife. Wife not compulsory for them any to provide for the husband. But if the wife any is rich, and the wife any voluntarily give money to the husband, is this permissible? Yes, permissible. Is it considered to be a debt? No. It depends. If the wife any voluntarily give money to the husband, this is not a debt. But if the wife any put a condition that this is a debt, that you have to pay me back, then khalas, any the husband any has to pay any the wife any back. And likewise, any when it comes to nafaqah, if the husband does not give nafaqah to the wife any has the right to ask nafaqah from the husband. This can be in the form any of debt. But if the wife any voluntarily say any that I do not need your money, or say that I will give you money instead, you don't have to pay me back at any time. You don't have to pay me back at all. Then this is any considered to be a gift, and it is permissible for the husband to accept any gifts from the wife, and this is not any considered to be a debt. So I hope any this is clear, inshallah. The third question is asking, assalamu alaikum ustaz, wa alaikum salam. Pawning gold at pawn shops is haram as it involves any interest. May I ask if it is permissible for a Muslim to purchase gold from pawn shop? Yani a question and he is asking, is it permissible to purchase gold from pawn shop? The basis any of buying gold and is permissible. If you buy gold with Singapore dollars, then there are two conditions any that we have to pay attention to. Two conditions. Number one, it has to be done on the spot. So when we purchase any gold, it has to be done on the spot. What is the meaning any on the spot? Meaning you give any the money and you take the gold. But if the shop any tells you, then I take any your money first, next month any you come and I give you the gold, this is riba. This is riba. This is called riba an-nasa. We have any this form any of riba, any that is called riba an-nasi'a or riba an-nasa. It is a delay in the transaction. When it comes to items that are ribawi, because gold any is a ribawi, ribawi any meaning, based on the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, al-zahabu bil-zahabi wal-fiddatu bil-fiddati, that when you exchange gold and gold, it has to be the same. And it has to be on the spot. Transaction and it has to be on the spot. And ownership also must be done any on the spot. Yani when we give any the money, when we take any the gold, the ownership is established, then we say this is permissible. That the sale any is valid. So point number one, it has to be on the spot. Point number two, the ownership must be established at the point of transaction. Clear, inshallah. So there is a difference between transaction, on the spot transaction, and ownership. Because sometimes you can have any on the spot transaction, but there is no ownership. This is also riba. And this is called riba al-yad. So riba any day are riba an-nasa, riba al-yad. When you exchange the same time, gold and gold, then it has to be the same. If you are exchanging, for example, 100 grams any of gold, 100 grams of gold, no problem. But if you exchange, for example, 100 grams of gold and 105 grams any of gold, now this 5 grams any is riba. This is called riba al-fadl. So we have riba al-fadl, we have riba al-nasa, we have riba al-yad. So whenever we want to purchase gold, if you are using money, yani Singapore dollars or Malaysian ringgit, then these two conditions any must be in place. When you purchase any the gold any at the shop, it must be on the spot transaction. And number two, it must have ownership to be established any at the point of transaction. Regardless whether you buy gold at a pawn shop or whatever shop any that you are buying, as long as the transaction any has no riba, then it is permissible. Number two, he's asking, how about purchasing gold from an outlet that practice rahn system? That is a sub-brand of a pawn shop and sells by gold with the same rate as it others other outlets. Yani this question, I do not know exactly how the system works But at the end of the day, what is important when we purchase gold and yes, what we mentioned, the two conditions must be present. If any of the conditions any is not present, then it is cannot considered to be valid. If the purchase any of gold and is based any on a loan, it is not valid. Because that's what we mentioned, it has to be done on the spot. Not any given any a time frame where you can collect any the gold any after some time. So likewise, online transaction any of gold is not permissible. Yani when we understand this, we understand online transaction is not permissible. Because why? Online any transaction any of gold, you pay the money first, but you do not get any the gold. The gold any is being delivered any to you after any a certain time. So that kind any of sale any is not any valid. Kita ada satu soalan yang terakhir, soalan dalam bahasa Melayu. Assalamualaikum Ustaz. Waalaikumsalam. Bila solat jahriyah sendirian dan ada yang masbuk, doa baca balik secara jahar from awal Fatihah, awal surah, or do I just start to recite secara jahar wherever I stop at? Bila solat jahriyah sendirian, saya solat secara sir dan ada yang masbuk, doa baca balik secara jahar from awal Fatihah ataupun awal surah. So basically this question is asking, if a person is praying the jahriyah prayer. So jahriyah prayer meaning, for example, maghrib, isya, fajr, this is jahriyah. Imam sunnah tu read out aloud. So there is someone who comes and he has a ma'mum, masbuk, comes. So this person is asking, if I am the person, the imam, do I recite loudly my Fatiha, or do I recite loudly from the beginning of Fatiha? Yani if this person is reciting any Fatiha and he's reciting quietly, but then the person becomes any the ma'mum, masbuk, so does he have to repeat the Fatiha from the beginning, or he continue the Fatiha and he recite loudly? The answer is you continue your Fatiha. But in this situation, it is a sunnah for you to recite loudly, because now you are the imam. Before that, and you are not the imam, even if you are not the imam, it is a sunnah you need to recite a bit loud. Because jahriyah any prayers any, not only any for the imam, I mean, even in munfarid, a person is praying by himself. But if an imam, a person and he recite any loudly in a way that the ma'mum can listen to his recitation. Jadi soalan ini dia menanyakan berkenaan dengan satu orang, dia baca Fatiha, solat jahriyah, ada makmum masbuk di belakangnya. Jadi soalan menanyakan, adakah saya perlu membaca Fatiha daripada awal ataupun saya meneruskan Fatiha? Jawapannya adalah dia meneruskan Fatiha. Dan apabila dia meneruskan Fatiha, dia baca dengan jahar. Sebab ini adalah solat jahriyah dan dia adalah menjadi imam sekarang. Jadi tak perlu dia bermula daripada awal Fatiha, sebab ini dia telah membaca Fatiha. Wallahu a'lam ini bisawab. Saya tahu kalau jemaah ada soalan, boleh tanya insyaAllah. The kids here, you have any question on Ramadan? Everything is good? How's your camp? Happy? You Abu Bakar, you got any question? Are you sure? So are you ready for Ramadan? Are you ready? You sure? So what is your readiness for Ramadan? What have you done? What have you done to prepare? What's that? Store food in the house. So Ramadan and the sunnah, you need to eat tamar, dates, when you break any fast. How about you? Is there any question? Wallahu a'lam bissawab. Rabbana taqabbal du'ana innaka antas samiu alim wa tub 'alaina innaka antat tawwabur rahim. Wa akhdim salihati 'amalan wa ajrana Allah ya karim fadl isman rabbika bil 'izzati 'amma yasifun. Assalamu 'ala al mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil 'alamin. Taqabbal Allah minkum. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.